The recording for this podcast is brought to you by the good folks from GoodPoliticsRadio.com. Thank you for listening.
Thank you for listening to the Talkstar Radio Network. For the finest and informative and interactive talk radio programming, it's the Talkstar Radio Network, available live via your local radio station and on the internet at TalkstarRadio.com. Your feedback is important to us. Email us at TalkstarRadio.com.
Chuck Harder!
Hi, we're back. Today seems to be difficult to reach our guest day, but we will continue to probe and reach out for our friend at the National Association of Railroad Passengers. You know, if you watch TV, and if you can spend some time on the Discovery Channel or some of those other science channels, you'll find out that once upon a time, the United States of America had the greatest rail systems, that's plural, in the world. I mean, we had every kind of rail system you could imagine. Between small towns, we had little rail lines called interurban. Sometimes they were only one or two cars, and they were powered by electric motors. And you could get on the interurban rail if car A was full, then they'd hook on car B, and you could go from town A to town B for about 25 cents or less. We had every kind of rail transportation you could think of in the cities, all kinds of trolleys, you name it. Well, how is it that America went from being the world's greatest railroad and rail society to what we have left today that the Bush administration is threatening to kill? And the answer is, it happened in 1936 when Standard Oil, Firestone, and General Motors and others formed National City Lines for the purpose of buying up railroad systems, putting them out of business, and then selling buses that used tires, obviously, and used oil. Ross Capon is with us. He is the director of the National Association of Railroad Passengers. Ross, welcome. I was talking about National City Lines while we were getting you on the air. Was that not a disaster, huh?
Well, yeah, that's a slightly separate subject. That's goes to local mass transit, and probably the most dramatic example is the billions of dollars that the Los Angeles, the Southern California area, has spent recreating a rail transit system that follows fairly closely the one that was destroyed ultimately as a result of the National City Lines story that you told.
Right. What is the current situation of railroads today? Why is it that the Bush administration has a knife out and wants to cut the heart out of Amtrak and essentially put it out of business? Why?
Well, I think that it's a program they don't understand. It's a kind of an oddball in the transportation sector because of the history of passenger rail, which was, if you go way back, it was never a separate for-profit business. It was always seen as a lost leader by the freight railroads. Back before airlines existed, the best express trains commanded the moguls of industry, and if they liked the experience they got on the passenger train, they would ship their freight on the same railroad. So we have this long history where passenger rail was not really seen as an independent standalone business. Then Amtrak was created in 1971, and Amtrak is a mixture of infrastructure owner, especially in the Northeast, and a carrier. So people try to draw the analogy with the airlines or the bus companies, and they say it's ridiculous you wouldn't have Greyhound put the New Jersey Turnpike costs on their balance sheet. But nobody expects bus companies to have highways on their balance sheet, but railroads do generally own their own tracks, and so it's just been very difficult for them to get their hands around it and understand it, and fairly easy for them to take pot shots at it. What's important, though, is the Republican-controlled House of Representatives in July voted overwhelmingly to more than double the amount of money that would go to Amtrak compared with what the administration wanted. Actually, the administration proposed zero, and the House voted for almost $1.2 billion, almost what they were getting in fiscal 05. And the Senate Appropriations Committee did likewise. So the administration is very frustrated by the fact that, as they would say, we're not going to get reform from Capitol Hill, even though we control it, supposedly.
Wow, now, did President Bush veto this money?
It's still in the pipeline. In fact, the appropriations bill is on the Senate floor today, this week. It's called the FUD bill. That's for Transportation, Treasury, Housing, and Urban Development. So the bill is there today, and so we do not have a final outcome for the funding for the current fiscal year. Most of the federal government is currently on a continuing resolution, which is set to expire in the middle of November, and so we don't really know what funding level Amtrak is going to get during the current fiscal year.
Now, does the Bush administration understand that that railroad transportation is much, much more efficient for the use of fuel than trucks, buses, or jet planes? You know, jet planes are dead last. Trucks and buses are way down the line. But the best use of fuel to transport anything, the first is ocean freight, and then the second is railroad. Now, why in the world doesn't the Bush administration, that wants to conserve energy, say, look, let's pack them into the railroads?
Well, of course, you got to acknowledge that the Bush administration's intense interest in conserving energy is fairly recent. It goes to the speech that President Bush gave after the hurricane disasters. You know, it was only a couple of years ago that Vice President Cheney was ridiculing the concept of energy conservation. So I think we'll give at least the president himself a little bit of credit for the public exhortation for people to conserve gasoline. I think the Bush administration understands the freight side of the picture, and they understand it because you don't have to vote federal money to keep the freight trains going, although even there, the traffic is growing incredibly quickly, and in order to provide the track capacity that we need on the railroads in order to prevent the highways from being completely overrun with big trucks, we are going to have to change that and start putting federal money into the freight railroad tracks. And some people in the freight railroad industry still have trouble getting their hands around that, and they'll tell you, well, we don't need the money, we can continue to make profits, but we won't be able to grow the infrastructure very much, which translates into a disaster for the highway system. So the Bush administration, I think, is a tendency to listen to what big business wants, and for the most part, big business is not telling them that a national passenger rail network is important or worth spending money on.
All right, Ross Kupon, hang on for just a minute. Let me do a two-minute break. When we reconvene, years ago, there was this nonsense of rails to trails, where they ripped up all the railroad and they said, oh, we're going to make bike trails and everybody will use them. The answer is they don't. Nobody ever uses them. I have one that goes by my house, and if I see three people a year, it's a lot. But the bottom line is this. How are we going to rebuild all of the railroad routes that have been torn up. You and I both know we got to do it, and we got to do it fast if we're going to save the country. How will this get done when you've got these people on Capitol Hill who, pardon the expression, just don't get it? We'll be right back with Russ Capon right after this timeout.
It's bad enough if you suffer asthma, but as a parent, the agony of watching your child struggling for breath must be agony beyond measure. What if there was a natural, effective, drug-free answer to asthma you'd want to know, wouldn't you? Well, I've been reading up on a little-known clinical trial at a major hospital that suggests you can be rid of asthma, asthma symptoms, and sinus and allergy symptoms to breathe easily, calmly, and in a more natural, relaxed way. It's guaranteed, or you get your money back, and you've got 90 days to decide. Look it up for yourself online at healthstarproducts.com. H-E-A-L-T-H, healthstarproducts.com. You've got 90 days to decide if this program works for you. If it doesn't, you get your money back. Go to www.healthstarproducts.com.
You shall have rings on your fingers and bells on your toes, and you shall have Chuck Carter wherever you go. Well, it doesn't exactly rhyme, nor is it grammatically correct. But it gets the point over that the Chuck Carter Show is now available on demand on iPod. To find out how to get the Chuck Carter Show anytime, anywhere on iPod, go to ChuckCarterShow.com. That's on the internet, www.ChuckCarterShow.com. And get the information on how to get Chuck Carter on demand on iPod. The Chuck Carter Show on iPod is brought to you in cooperation with Good Politics Radio and Talkstar Radio Network. Yes, now you can listen to Chuck Carter anytime, anywhere on iPod. Go to www.ChuckCarterShow.com to find out how to iPod.
Ross Capon is the director of the National Association of Railroad Passengers. Give out your website, Ross.
Yeah, it's www.nutrail.org. That's N as in Nancy, A, R, P as in Paul, RAIL.org. We're very proud of the website, and we in particular have a hotline that we update most Friday afternoons, and a fact-check section which responds to a lot of the misinformation that critics of Amtrak have been putting out this year.
All right, that said, you know, years ago I used to ride the airplane from Tampa, Florida to Chicago. And there was a stopover in Atlanta. This was before the days of this, the screening and what have you. But just with the typical delay of having to go to the airport, parking the car, getting there in time, changing planes in Atlanta, getting off the plane at O'Hare, getting to downtown Chicago, I would see about 8 hours go by. From the time I got on the plane or I left the house in Tampa until the time I got into downtown Chicago. If we had a modern railroad system, like they have in Europe or what have you, I could have done the same thing. I could have gotten into a passenger train in Tampa, Florida, and arrived in Chicago in 6 hours and been right in downtown and saved an awful lot of energy. Now, that's what they're doing in Europe. You can go from downtown Paris to downtown London in, I think it's about 3 hours, and they even beat the pants off the airplanes.
Well, that's true. I think in this country, we're sort of in a position of walk before you run. If we could do reliable 80-mile-an-hour operation on a lot of shorter runs, like Chicago-Detroit and Chicago-St. Louis, we would be well ahead of where we are today and going further down into the future. If we could ratchet the speed up, we'd be able to perhaps connect Chicago, excuse me, Chicago and New York, and maybe eventually do Chicago-Tampa. But we've got such a long way to go.
How do we rebuild where they have torn up the railroads. I mean, when I saw that happening, it just broke my heart. I mean, you talk about industrial strength stupidity. What a resource that was just torn up.
Yeah, well, that's what happens when you put infrastructure into the private sector, and the private companies have to, before they can invest, they have to meet all kinds of hurdles on economics that your state highway department doesn't have to even think about. You know, it's nothing for a state highway department to say we're going to connect every city in our state with a population of X or more with a freeway. No economic analysis, you just build it in and they'll come. So I think that there's some encouraging examples where there's a progressive state government like you have in North Carolina, and there's a specific right-of-way that was abandoned that has a very specific use. They're looking to restore a direct line between Richmond and Raleigh so that we don't have to do what Amtrak does today, which is kind of go straight east to near Rocky Mountain, turn left, and then go north, two sides of a triangle. And so there's a serious program there. I think they may have even completed or are nearing completion of an environmental impact statement to put that track back. But to get anything done of significance is going to require the creation of a federal-state funding partnership, and that's S-1516. It's a bill that may be on the Senate floor before the Senate adjourns. It's a bipartisan bill that Senators Lott and Lautenberg have taken the lead on, Republican from Mississippi and Democrat from New Jersey, and it would include that federal partnership, because right now, if I'm a state government and I've got some money to spend on transportation, the federal government is essentially bribing me to spend it on highways or aviation, where the feds will match with about 80% of the cost of the project. For most rail projects right now, the match is zero. So we've got to get that fixed so that state governments will have some incentive to do more of what a handful of state governments have already done.
How do we get this done?
Well, I mean, having a bipartisan bill is a good start. The fact that the chairman of the Senate Commerce Committee, Ted Stevens of Alaska, and the ranking Democrat, Senator Inouye from Hawaii, are both strongly supporting the bill is certainly a good sign. It certainly wouldn't hurt if listeners told their senators that S-1516 is a good bill that needs to get passed, and that we need to fully fund Amtrak in the Fed appropriations bill, where it's $1.45 billion. Sounds like the worst nightmare to the White House budget office, but as you said, they don't get it.
I think the big question is, if we do not reform our transportation systems in the United States, hybrid cars are fine, and that's good. But before hybrid cars will dominate the market on the streets and highways of America, 10 years is going to go by. The amount of vehicles that are on the roads right now that get somewhere in the area of 10 miles per gallon or less or just a slightly more is absolutely overwhelming. Probably most American middle-class families own two of them. And they don't go very far on $3 a gallon gasoline. And I just am looking at the economic impact on this country regarding the use of fuel, etc., if we don't reform and reform very soon. If we started rebuilding rail systems today, it would be like rebuilding New Orleans. Maybe in 5 years you might see some progress. But we would have to start, like, right now. When we get back, give us, if you would, some of the timetables that you think are possible to rebuild rail and light rail in the United States. We're talking to Ross Capon, who is the executive director of the National Association of Railroad Passengers on TalkStar.
Now we flash back to the year 1945. Soviet troops enter Berlin on the 21st of April. Hitler shoots himself on the 30th. Germany formally capitulates on May 7th. But America's wartime president, FDR, lives to see none of this. He dies on April the 12th. Legendary radio performer Arthur Godfrey describes his funeral.
Drums wrapped in black vapor are muffled, as you can hear. The pace of the musicians is so slow, and behind them these are Navy boys, and now just coming past the treasury, I can see the horses drawing the caissons, and most generally folks having as tough a time as I am trying to see it. And behind us is the car bearing the man on whose shoulders now falls the terrific burdens and responsibilities that were handled so well by the man to whose body we're paying our last respects now. God bless him, President Truman. We return you now to the studio.
The concentration camps at Dachau and Auschwitz were liberated. Mussolini was shot by Italian partisans on the 28th of April. And bebop emerged as a reaction to swing. At the movies...
Oh, that comes off your check, too. Keep your own tips. Here, have your tea.
Thank you. What's your name?
Ida. What's yours?
Mildred Pierce.
Some of the events of the year 1945 on Flashback.
Ross Capon with the National Association of Railroad Passengers. Give us a timetable. Have you done any studies on that?
Well, there's one very simple statistic I can give you, and that is if in many of the corridors that Amtrak is running in right now, the seats are all filled and they need more seats. It would take about 3 years from the day that you can place an order for new rolling stock to get those cars on the railroad and make a difference. I wanted to, and of course the 3 years isn't going to start counting until we get this federal program passed. There's some optimism about the Senate this year, but you have to wonder if we can get anything done until there's some significant change in Washington. I do want to point to three very optimistic things that tells you that the people are ahead of the politicians. Number one is, of course, the increased ridership on Amtrak. They just announced another in a string of ridership increase years, over 25 million passengers. And the American Public Transportation Association likewise announced ridership increases on many of the rail transit systems. Secondly, there's an increasing trend towards developing the urban cores as opposed to the sprawling suburbs. This is being driven by perhaps the price of gasoline, and the real estate development patterns are fairly important, especially for local transit, but also for intercity travel. If huge numbers of residences and workplaces are not convenient to anything but the freeway, it's going to be hard to get people to use rail. And finally, gasoline consumption itself is off, and the automobile manufacturers, especially General Motors, are getting loud messages about from the marketplace about the virtues of fuel efficiency. So I think going forward, there are some reasons to be optimistic. At the same time, I'm worried about, as we've discussed earlier, how much damage can be done to Amtrak in the present political climate.
Why would they do that?
There is a belief that in some quarters that Amtrak's national system is a waste of money. Never mind the fact that if you got rid of it and just had a few short corridors, there would only be 21 states getting service and probably not enough to generate any interest on Capitol Hill. It's just, I think, a lack of vision, a refusal to acknowledge the extent of progress that Amtrak has made in the past few years, and a desire to find places to cut the budget. You know, they think, they hope the blood is on the floor with Amtrak, and they can find a little bit of spending to cut here, even though it's a tiny fraction of the transportation budget, let alone the federal budget as a whole.
Well, I got to tell you, people who fly in airplanes nowadays tell me they're not exactly very happy flights. It's like flying in a cattle car. And I avoid them at all costs. If I can find any other way other than going by airline, I will do it, even if I have to drive. The point of it is that we are at a turning point in the United States where we've got to realize that we've got a whole lot to fix, but we better fix it quick. Ross, give out your website one more time, would you?
www.narpril.org. That's narpril.org.
Well, Stephen, thank you for being with us, sir.
Thanks for having me, Chuck.
You bet. We'll talk again. Ladies and gentlemen, God bless America, our troops, all of those in harm's way. We have other storms approaching. I hope for the best and for those who have suffered. Lord knows we wish you so, so very well. If we don't do something for America now, when will we? And if not us, whom? Think about it. If you'd like to help us, it's For the People, P.O. Box 150, Tampa, Florida, 33601. Donations are tax deductible. God bless America. Aloha.
The views expressed on this podcast are not necessarily the views of the good folks from goodpoliticsradio.com. However, we do welcome your comments on this podcast, and we would love to hear from you. This is Tim Loomis from goodpoliticsradio.com. Thank you for listening.